soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his whole. Slow to anger, your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. My strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever. I will worship your holy name, Jesus, I worship your holy name. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you on this sticky Missouri Sunday morning. The air conditioner has been on for 2 days, and I am still just profusely pouring water on all these beautiful flowers up here. So it's just good to be with you today. The flowers are in memory of Nick Johnson, if you know Albert and Diane, their son, who passed away this week, and yesterday was his homegoing service. So it's been quite an eventful week. Ken and Diane, good morning. Did you make it back without rain? Rocky called me and said, hey, we're going to wear this shirt today. So it's the 50th anniversary of Lake Beauty. We're going to be talking about Lake Beauty a little bit later in the morning. Dan May has his on as well. And we'll have a special message from Luke Corthus about Lake Beauty and Joel and Kim Delp about Ecuador. It's Mission Sunday. And I want to share with you the verses that that they asked us to read as a part of their message. And I'm so excited because at the end of it, it's going to tie right into what we're doing this morning. Think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. You, we think of ourselves and we're hard on ourselves. We beat ourselves up all the time. Think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. He had equal status with God, but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave, became human. Having become a human, he stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. Think about that. The Son of God on his throne, high in heaven, reigning and ruling over all, forsaking all of that, comes to earth, laying aside his heavenly riches, becomes a man like you and I. It was an incredible, humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless and obedient life and then died a selfless, obedient death. And the worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion. Because of that obedience, God lifted him high and honored him far beyond anyone or anything, ever soul that all created beings in heaven and on earth, even those long ago dead and buried, will bow and worship before this Jesus Christ and call out in praise that he is the master of all to the glorious honor of God the Father. I don't know about you, but I don't want to wait until I'm on the other side of the ground to worship Jesus, to bow in honor of God the Father. I don't want to waste the life that I've been given and not pour out to him all of my adoration and praise. Because like he says, Brian, if you don't do that, these flowers here are going to start singing. The rocks are going to cry out. So I'm going to invite you to worship with us this morning. Got a couple of new songs that we're going to throw at you. There are multiple ways that we can worship God listed through the Psalms. Some of the ones that I love: come before his presence with singing, clap your hands, shout for joy unto God with a voice of triumph, lift up holy hands and bless the Lord in his tabernacle. Hear, O God, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Listen. Maybe you might catch on some of the melody and some of the lyrics, and maybe they might be more familiar to you than I know, but allow yourself to be encompassed by God's presence in this place this morning, whether the song is a familiar one or not. Is that good? Is that all right? Lean into him, sense his presence, and worship him with all of our hearts. You are light in the darkness. You are hope for the hopeless. You are the God who never fails. You are full of compassion. You are love everlasting. You are the God who never fails. Through it all, your love never changes. Through it all, there is nothing to fear. Your name we're lifting higher. Your glory our desire. Your praise will sing forever. Our great God, whoa, no strength, no power greater, no equal to our Savior. You're the name above all others. Our great God, whoa. strong through the ages, our song to all generations. Our mighty God has come to save. And through it all, your love never changes. Through it all, there is nothing to fear. Your name we're lifting higher. Your glory I desire. Your praise we'll sing forever. Our great God, whoa. No strength, no power greater. No equal to our Savior. You're the name above all others. Our great God, whoa. Been fulfilled, death exchanged for life. Perfect love has been revealed. Our God is alive. All our hope has been fulfilled. Death exchanged for life. Perfect love has been revealed. Our God is alive. Your name we're lifting higher. Your glory I desire. Your praise will sing forever. Our great God, whoa. No strength, no power greater. No equal to our Savior. You're the name above all others. Our great God, whoa. You're the name above all others. Our great God, whoa.
From heaven to earth, you delivered us all, it's eternally heard. I searched for truth, and all I found was you. My God, I'll only ever give my all.
Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you. Oh, oh, oh,
I'll praise, and all we are today.
Take it all, take it all.
You sent your son from heaven to earth. You delivered us all, it's eternally heard. I searched for truth, and all I found was you. My God, I'll only ever give my all.
Jesus, we're living for your name. Never be ashamed of you. Oh, oh, oh.
All praise, and all we are today.
Take it all, take it all.
Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed.
Take it all.
Running to the one who heals the blind, following the shining light. In your hands the power to save the world in my eyes. Running to the one who heals the blind, following the shining light. In your hands the power to save the world.
Muerte yo viviré, de ti nunca me avergonzaré.
Oh, oh, oh.
Ser hoy todo lo que soy. Toma, tómalo, toma, tómalo.
Jesús, muerte yo viviré, de ti nunca me avergonzaré.
Oh, oh, oh.
Ser hoy todo lo que soy.
Toma, tómalo, toma, tómalo.
Jesús, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you.
Oh, oh, oh.
I'll
somebody near you and say hello. Maybe four or five somebodies. Ready? Go. Shine, it's his, right? Exodus 15:11, Psalm 86:8 have been stirring in my soul lately. They keep coming up. Exodus 15:11 says, who is there like you among the gods in the heavens? Whose works are like yours? And Psalm 86 answers and says, there's no one like you, O God, in the heavens. There's no one whose works are like yours. There is no one higher. That's the song we're going to do next. It's very, it might be very unfamiliar. I think it's very singable, but I'm going to invite you to sit and listen as we start. And then as it begins to resonate with you and as you begin to join with us, feel free to stand and bow your hearts before God. Hearts together, there's no one higher than you. Redeemer, defender, our great and mighty Savior, there's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for us is always enough. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. Majestic in wonder, you reign with love forever. There's no one higher than you. Your beauty, your splendor, your glory knows no measure. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. And by your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for us is always enough. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater. astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for us is always enough. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. There is no one higher than you. God, there is no one higher than you. There is none like you, O Lord, in the heavens. We do stand amazed in your presence that you would take people like us, sinners, people separated and far from the love of God, and you would call us to your side. That you would redeem this whole world through your Son, Jesus. God, for all the times that we don't live like you're higher, for all the times that we don't show the love that is greater, we ask your forgiveness. God, for all those times that we exalt ourselves and our own thoughts and elevate the things in our life to a place of prominence above you, we confess that and ask that you would forgive us of that. Because there is no one higher than you, God. Our hands lifted high in surrender. All that we are, we pledge to you. God, may your glory, may your honor, may your name, may your power, may your presence, may everything that you are reign supremely in this place, in our hearts, in this community, and in this world that you've called us to take the gospel to. God, thank you. Thank you that a high and holy God like you would love someone like us. Thank you, God. Amen. You can be seated. We have a couple of videos for you. It kind of seems weird to do it after a moment like that. But some upcoming events and then a special message from Luke Korthus. Let's take a look.
Welcome to First Covenant Church. We're so glad you're here. Happy Mother's Day.
You know what?
Today you'll be hearing a great message from Pastor Dan May, our newest kid on the block.
Skip that one completely. There should be one called Happenings at 801 with no other things on it. Okay, so some things that are coming up that you need to know about. This Tuesday night, I'll tell you what, it's amazing that God will use someone like me who is wrought with mistakes. And Carrie says, amen, brother, you have no idea. Tuesday night, we have a forum, a constitutional forum at 6 o'clock. For those of you who still have questions about the Constitution, come. Bring your questions. We'll try to answer what we can. Wednesday night at 6, the Awana children are inviting you. Point to your neighbor and say, you. Now point to yourself and say, me. To their Awana Awards Night Ice Cream Social Extravaganza event, 6 o'clock. Come. Celebrate with our kids. Celebrate with our volunteers. And then on Thursday night, we want to honor you, our volunteers in the church, not just our Awana volunteers, but every capacity that you serve in within the church. We want to honor you as volunteers and say that we appreciate you and we love you. And so we are doing a dessert luau on Thursday night at 7 o'clock. There'll be door prizes and games and fellowship and desserts. And you don't have to bring anything unless you and I have talked. Then you can bring that. Don't leave me hanging now. But that's at 7. It'll be a great time. And then a week from Wednesday, right, the 29th, is our congregational meeting. And that's where we're voting on new members and we're voting on this constitution that we have been hearing so much about. So make plans to attend all of that. Now, without further ado, the fabulous Luke Korthus. My fingers are crossed.
Hello, First Covenant Church. My name is Luke Corthus. I'm the future intern here at Lake Beauty Bible Camp, and today I'm going to talk about some of the ministries that Lake Beauty does.
Lake Beauty Bible Camp was founded in 1963. This year's their 50th anniversary.
In fifth grade, I came here as a camper, and I gave my life to Christ. God definitely works in cool ways here. I really like that you can come here, and you can see God in everything. You can see the nature. You can get away from the technology. You can just come here and, like, have fun and be with God. I was a counselor here at Lake Beauty last summer, and I got to see firsthand of how God used this ministry to touch the lives of his children. So the offering that you guys are taking today is going to go towards the Lake Beauty Camp Scholarship Fund. This money goes to the kids that really want to go to camp, but they don't have, their family doesn't have the money to send them. Our goal at Lake Beauty is to send everybody that wants to go to camp. I definitely pray that God would bless you as you give today, and I pray that you would keep thinking of us in the next summer. Thanks.
Well, if Luke says, it must be true, right? You know, we had confirmation the first of the month. Some of our kids got up and they talked about Lake Beauty, how they came to know Christ. We had a funeral here yesterday, and with Nick Johnson's family, for Nick. And Nick came to know Christ at Bible camp when he was in third grade. Luke talked about fifth grade. You know, that is something we don't want to stop. We want it to grow, amen? And so today, we have a real privilege to give. We're going to have a regular offering of tithes and offerings. That's important for us as we continue to minister in our backyard. But we also partner with Lake Beauty. There's some awesome things happening there. And maybe for some of you out there, your kids are grown, and this is not where you are right now, but you can help step in and give generously to this fund so that other kids can go, and so that every kid in this place who wants to go to camp, every family that wants to send, finances will not be an issue. So you can do your regular offering, and then maybe you have a separate check or somehow earmark it on your envelope. This is for my Lake Beauty, every kid a camper offering. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward right now, and I'm going to ask God to bless you as you give. Lord God, we thank you that you are changing lives. You are helping our young people come to know Christ, to grow in Christ, and to serve you with great joy and power. So we thank you for Luke's testimony, for others that we have heard about. And God, as we give our offering today, our tithes, we want to see this ministry here in our backyard at First Covenant grow. We continue to partner with the ministry at Lake Beauty. We want to see that grow because we have seen that we work together very well. And those kids that come to know Christ here, they come to know Christ there. But the key is they come to know you and love you and follow you. Bless the giver and the gifts for your glory and honor. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Could we live like your grace is stronger than all our faults and failures? Could we live like your love is deeper than our hearts could fathom? Could we live like this? Could we live like your name is higher than every other power? Could we live like your ways are deeper than our understanding? So could we live like this? Could we live like this? And yes, our God is all he says he is. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. We stand in your love, in your power, all you say we are. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. That your grace is stronger than all our faults and failures. We believe that your love is deeper than our hearts could fathom. So could we live like this? And could we live like this? And yes, our God is all he says. All he says he is. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. And so we stand in your love, in your power, all you say we are. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. We're singing, yeah. Lord, yes, Lord, what else could we say? What else could we say? Singing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, we're going all the way. We're going all the way. We're gonna live like this, and yes, our God is all he says. All he says he is. Yes, our God is all he says. All he says he is. Yes, our God is all he says. All he says he is. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. So we stand in your love, in your power, and all you say we are. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. Jesus, in your name we could change the world. Jesus, in your name we could change the world.
I know your hearts have been blessed with worship and with singing, and now I know they're going to be blessed with a special treat we have this morning. I'm going to ask Joel and Kim Delp to come up. You know, for those of us who went to Ecuador in 2011, we had about 30, 31, something like that. We had the privilege to meet Joel and Kim, and they were short-term missionaries down there. We hung out at camp together. Kind of heard about some of their vision, their ideas for what they wanted to see happen in Ecuador. They were partnering together with the Covenant Church there. Well, they were short-term missionaries. Now they're long-term missionaries. Isn't that great? We think that's awesome, too. And so today, you're going to hear their heart, and you're going to hear their vision for next steps. And we're going to talk, you know, as a church, we're just praying. God, we have sent teams down. We have a heart. We've got friends there. What are some of our next steps in Ecuador? So listen closely, listen prayerfully, but I'm going to pray for them before they share with us, and then just may God be with us in these moments. Can I pray with you guys? Lord, we just thank you for Joel and Kim and their just coming from Indiana up here to share with us, to share and to partner with us. We have a similar heart for seeing you at work in a powerful way in Ecuador with some very special people. So anoint them this morning to share and help us just to capture what you're doing there in their lives and how that can be a blessing to us as well. And just be with them in Jesus' name.
Joel and Kim Delp, and we are Covenant long-term missionaries to Ecuador, South America. In our next term, we are hoping to assist the Covenant National Church of Ecuador in starting two homes for at-risk children and a medical clinic. Each home will see its goal as reunifying the children with their families. We bring greetings from our friends and brothers and sisters in Christ to you from the Covenant Church of Ecuador. And they want you to know that they are praying for you and that they covet your prayers as well.
I'm going to start off by sharing a brief word from the scripture that was read earlier, Philippians 2, verses 5 through 11. Our call to ministry is not one of high esteem. It's not this grand calling that God has picked out some great people to do his will. Rather, our call is that of service and follows the model that Christ has provided for us, as the Apostle Paul explained in this text from Philippians. This passage that was read as one of the more confusing statements in the New Testament, especially in the NIV version, when Paul says that Jesus Christ did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. The question immediately comes to mind, well, why didn't he consider equality with God something to be grasped? Wasn't Jesus Christ both fully God and fully human during his earthly ministry? So wasn't he equal with God? Well, the problem there is in that interpretation of the Greek to English. A better way to translate that statement from the Greek is that Jesus Christ did not take advantage of the fact that he was God in human form. Or maybe another way is that he didn't exploit the fact that he was God. Basically, what the Apostle Paul is implying is that Jesus Christ did not have to die on a cross because he was God. God can do anything because he is God. So he could have chosen to not do it, but he didn't, did he? Scripture says that he humbled himself and was obedient until death, even death on a cross. We are here today. We're going to be presenting who we are and what we have been doing and what we are called to in the future. And the plans that God has for us are very big. But please hear what I'm saying now. God has not given us these big plans because we are these great people who God has to utilize our awesome talents and our amazing gifts for ministry. Rather, we feel quite the opposite. We feel like Moses asking the burning bush, "Why me, God?" We often do not feel adequate for what we are called to. However, one thing is true. Our call is the same as that of Christ Jesus. We are called to be servants. We are called and we must be obedient or else we'd be outside the will of God. All it takes for us is to have a heart of servitude and one that says that we are willing to die on a cross for what we are called to. And this isn't just a message for us or just those who are called to be missionaries overseas. Rather, it's a call for all of his believers. We are all called to be obedient, called to be missionaries to those in our world. We all can do something that Jesus Christ did for us in dying on the cross. That is to be a servant. All it takes is a servant's heart. Amen. We're going to be sharing this morning about our project, what we've been doing, and what we're called to do in the future. But we just wanted to share a little bit of background information on us so you get a chance to know us a little bit. I grew up in the east side of Cleveland in Ohio, and I grew up in a really strong Mennonite Christian home. I used to joke growing up that we were pretty much inside the church every time they unlocked the doors. So it's a really strong Christian home. It's a great place for me to grow up, but I actually didn't accept Jesus Christ into my heart until the age of 16 when I made a personal decision for him. And at that point, my life just totally changed the direction it was going, and I really wanted to get into the Word. I wanted to learn more about Jesus Christ and just do things for him. With this commitment, I also made the decision to go to a Christian university, Indiana Wesleyan University in Indiana. That's where we met, to further my education, but to also to continue to explore my faith and to learn more. And it was specifically at Indiana Wesleyan that I attended. They had chapel services, mandatory chapel services, three times per week, which I actually loved. I was getting so much out of them, and I was starting to sense that God was calling me to something, some form of ministry, but I didn't know what that was. Until my senior year, I had a good friend by the name of Jeremy Hawk. He told me, "Joel, I'm going on this missions trip to Honduras over spring break. I want you to go with me." I'm like, "Well, I've never done anything like that. Sure, why not?" And he said, "And it costs $1,200. I was like, "Whoa, I'm this poor college kid. I can't afford that. And no one's going to give me money to go on this mission trip." That was a completely foreign concept for me, so I didn't know how that was going to work out. So I told him I couldn't go. But it was obvious that God wanted me to go on that mission trip, because 1 week before Jeremy was set to leave, he came back to me and said, "Joel, I just found out that I raised twice what I need to go to Honduras. I want you to use the second half of what I raised to go with me." Right then and there, I knew God was speaking to me, and okay, I'm going to go to Honduras. And it was even more of a confirmation when I found out I got my passport in less than a week to be able to make the trip. So it was definitely God working. Yeah, for those of you who have gotten a passport, you know that's really fast. So it was obvious that God wanted me to be there, and I knew why once I arrived. Just opened up a whole new world for me and traveling to a developing country and seeing the needs there. But God especially impressed on my heart the work of missionaries, and I saw the important work that missionaries were doing, and I started to sense that that's what God was calling me to. With that initial trip, I made a commitment to return to Honduras to explore missions some more. Had a wonderful experience, and just a confirmation that God was calling me to use my life for overseas missionary work. And it was actually there in Honduras that God also impressed on me children. I saw children everywhere, children that were just lacking so many basic necessities. And I just reflected on my own life, and I reflected on how I've had everything I've needed, but most importantly, I had two loving parents that have provided for me everything I need and has most importantly taught me about Jesus Christ. So it was there in Honduras that God impressed on me that he wanted me to do something with children in at-risk situations. After my time in Honduras, I knew I was going to be a missionary, but I realized I wanted to get more education. And so I decided to get a master's in divinity degree, a degree that would prepare me for career work as a missionary. But then as I got to thinking about it and what we were planning together, I thought it would be good to get a good background in business. And so I decided I want to get a master's in business administration also. And if you haven't caught on yet, up to this point, we had never heard of the covenant. But I decided to go to seminary in Chicago, started looking into seminaries in Chicago, found North Park Theological Seminary, and found out that they're about the only seminary in the world that has a dual degree program where you can get a master's in divinity and a master's in business administration all as one curriculum. And so we ended up at North Park, and we're introduced to the covenant, and kind of the rest is history. We found our church home with the covenant.
And I also grew up in, I got it, okay.
Just trying to help.
I like this. This is powerful. I don't get the remote at home, so I get to use this. No, I'm just kidding. I grew up in a semi-Christian home. I grew up in Upland, Indiana. If you've heard of Taylor University, that's the town that I grew up in. And my mom was kind of the primary leader of everything Christian in our home, especially in the early years. And through her work at a mission organization called World Gospel Mission, I was able as a really young age to go on multiple mission trips growing up. The first of which was when I was 9 years old. And that was the first time I really got to see what missionaries were. I had heard all about them growing up, but I really got to see what they did. And that was very impressionable for me. My dad also became a Christian on that trip. So that was very influential in my life. The following year, actually where this picture was taken, is in Kenya, Africa, and it was there that I saw medical missionaries in action, and I got to actually see a surgery at that point and a baby born when I was just 10, and it was obviously very impressionable on me, but I realized then that I wanted to be a medical missionary, and at the age of 10, I'm sure my parents were like, oh, that's great, but to see it actually starting to come to fruition now has been a huge blessing for them, and that's pretty exciting for them as well. So my mom actually has a very significant impact on my life of reading the Bible to me growing up and just showing me what it was like to be a Christian. So I went on with high school and eventually decided to attend a Christian university as well. I actually went to Asbury College for a year. And then Joel and I met at Indiana Wesleyan University where I started my nursing degree. And eventually finished up at North Park at their undergraduate program. The importance of that time in my life was great. Joel and I actually went on a mission trip together before we got married to South America. And it was there that I saw nurses running clinics. And I thought, well, if they can do it, then why can't I do it? And so it was really at that point that God started tying everything together, and I realized that God wanted me to start a clinic. And so we got married in 2002. Actually, last weekend was our 11th anniversary. And this picture, this collage of pictures is actually what our time was like when we were in Chicago. It was craziness. We got married in May and then moved to Chicago in June, both from the middle of basically nowhere and moved to the big city of Chicago. So that was a life change in itself. But then we both started working full time, going to school full time, and we did that for like the next 7 to 8 years. And I finished up my nursing degree at North Park and then went on to Rush University to get my master's in nursing, and currently I'm a family nurse practitioner. So one thing that I always like to say is that I'm not just following Joel around on his adventure of being a missionary. I received my call to be a missionary way before I met him, and we have had separate calls that God has really woven together. And so I really take a lot of stock in that God has prepared us and that God has really woven our lives together.
But yeah, those were 8 long years of being in Chicago and studying and date nights in the library, that kind of thing. So that's a good representation of what our life was like, but it was a good time of preparation for us. Our first term in Ecuador was from June 2010 until October 2012. As Pastor Dan was sharing, we were short-term missionaries with the Covenant. The Covenant views your initial experience as short-termers as a time of learning and growth, rather than completing a lot of big projects. And so our main goals were learning the language, learning culture, and developing relationships that would sustain us over the long term. So we basically told the National Church, the Covenant National Church in Ecuador, that we would just like to get involved in whatever they would like us to. So they did. They plugged us in different places. I used my background as a pastor to preach and teach. The picture that you see up there is a renewal of wedding vows service. Go ahead. One of the main areas that you guys, a lot of you know about, is the Covenant Camp in Santo Domingo. Basically, the Covenant National Church has one campgrounds, like we have many campgrounds here in the States. They have one campgrounds. And they asked me to bring my experience and education with business to kind of come alongside the campgrounds to help develop it a little bit. The main highlight from that area is that actually right now they're breaking ground on new construction to build a pool, to renovate the kitchen, and to start the process of building family cabins. These are all happening by the process of donations that are being received by Covenant campgrounds here in the States, that when campers over the summer months go to the camp, this is all last year, they gave money towards a mission project. Well, those missions funds went to the Ecuador campground. So we're really excited about that. It's gonna be a huge blessing for the campgrounds in Santo Domingo. The last area that I was involved in, again, kind of utilizing my experience with business, just getting involved in social projects that are done through the Covenant Church. The pictures you see there is one of the projects that I spent a lot of time with, where we were helping an impoverished community develop a new cash crop of growing a delicacy-style mushroom. So what you see in front of the lady there is this delicacy-style mushroom that they're going to sell in high-end restaurants in the cities.
And I used my background in nursing and was asked to do multiple workshops in the jungle areas with indigenous young people to help them more learn about disabilities. Disabilities are more prevalent in the indigenous communities there, and so they just wanted me to come alongside the kids and talk with them about ways to prevent disabilities, things that cause disabilities, and give them an understanding of what that means. So these are just some of the kids. We gave them a project to do. Each of them were simulating what it would be like to have a different disability, and then they were given a project to build this really big tower of straws using working together and trying to do that. The second area that I did was working in another indigenous community, teaching about HIV and AIDS education, and realized very quickly that basic knowledge of what a virus, what a bacteria is, things that we kind of know, they just don't have an understanding of what that is. So it was a very long 4 weeks of trying to explain all of this, basic knowledge that I have, but trying to explain it in Spanish and trying to do it in a way that would be understandable. So we did a lot of ways to simulate it by different games and projects and just ways to simulate it. So that was very fun. And the last thing that I did was working in our local church teaching Sunday school classes. Anybody who's taught Sunday school realizes that this is not how it normally is. They are making me look really good, but that's really not how it normally was. None of them sat still.
Wasn't quite a typical Sunday picture there. Okay, so you all know that we've had this desire to start a ministry to our children and through medicine. And we shared that with the Covenant National Church when we first arrived. And they were excited about that because those aren't ministries that they currently have. They have similar kind of ministries, but not those ministries exactly. And so they were excited about it. We were excited about the future possibilities in Ecuador. But we decided to go along this formal process of to see if it was a good idea. We actually just researched the needs in Ecuador to see if these are areas in which there are needs for more ministries in this kind of way. So we did a statistical analysis, basically, and put together information and presented a report to the Advisory Council of the National Church. And they took that information and said, this is really good. This is helpful to know that there is the need, there are needs in these areas. But now we want you to go and see for yourself. We want you guys to go out and visit ministries to children to take a look at it yourself, to ask questions, to learn. And so that's what we did. It was this 2.5 month process in which we visited over 20 different sites, ended up with a 33-page report written in Spanish, which again, we presented to the Advisory Council of the National Church, and they read it and said, this is perfect. This is exactly what we need, and here's the decision we're gonna make. So we'll share what that decision was.
So this is where Ecuador is. This is South America. And Joel will use his pointer to show you. He has the power now.
Just a pointer.
to show you where Ecuador is. And then we just want to tell you where we're going to be working. So we live in Quito, which is the capital city. And just north of that, you see the little airplane. Just north of that, you see a city called Cayambe. That's where the National Church asked us to go. It wasn't a decision we made, but they just said, this is where we want you to go. And it actually worked out really well. When we were doing the field study, we went to visit this area and met a pastor named Pastor Jose. And he said, this is great. We've been waiting for you to come. He said, a few years ago, we really felt that God was telling us to build a clinic. And we didn't know how that was going to happen. We didn't know how it was going to be staffed, but we just felt like God wanted us to build a clinic. And now that you're coming, now you can staff the clinic. And so that's been really exciting to see how God's really worked that out. So this is the first area where we're going to be working in Cayambe. The second area just north of there, the little red dot, is Ibarra, and that's the second area where we're going to be working. Oh, wait, I forgot, sorry.
No problem.
So basically, we've talked a little bit about our ministry and that we're going to be working with children that are at risk. The first question that we always get are, what are at-risk children? Well, they're basically the same here as they are in Ecuador, as they are in Africa. An at-risk child is the same everywhere you go. It's basically a child that's in a vulnerable situation where their safety is at risk. So these can be areas of abandonment, abuse, family members that are having difficulty with alcohol and drug abuse, kids that are separated from their families because of financial stresses or related to work. Areas of human trafficking, forced labor. Anybody who's been to a developing country, you've probably seen children selling gum on the side of the road or wanting to shine your shoes or something like that. Most of those children don't want to do that, but they're forced to do it from their families or from other people that have forced them to do that. So those are the children that we'll be working with.
Also with basically, with the National Church's guidance, we made decisions as to how the homes themselves will look. As we just showed you, there'll be two homes initially. Each home, and just so you know, a lot of this is actually just following international guidelines as to how to best take care of at-risk children. A lot of this comes down from UNICEF or the UN as far as what's the best way to take care of an at-risk child. The homes themselves will be up to 8 children, but not more than 8 children. And each home will have a Christian foster mother and father. And each couple, we're hoping, will be from the local Covenant Church that we're working with. The children will have the support of a social worker, a psychologist, and a lawyer. That's so that they can get into the situation, they can see what's going on with them and their family. But the idea is that the children will be eventually reunified with their families. So rather than being a home in which it just kind of collects children, the idea is to receive the children, get them in a safe place, but then eventually reunify them with the family. So it's a ministry that looks inward at the children, but also outward at the families. The other area that we're trying to build into what we're doing with the homes is long-term sustainability. The main way that we're going to be doing that is that each each home will be working with a local covenant church. We're partnering with Iglesia Emmanuel, the church that Kim was sharing about with the first home. And as I was sharing, the parents will hopefully come from that church, and the children will attend that church, and they'll basically be a part of that church. As well as there'll be a surrounding area of covenant churches that will also be there to support the church. So they'll have a strong support system. The other way is that we're hoping to be able to provide economic resources for the homes. The idea is that the homes won't be eternally sustained by outside monies, that eventually they'll be self-sustainable. And so what we're hoping to do is to start micro-enterprises. One possible idea is to start a rose plantation. The first home is going to be in Cayambe, where a lot of our country, the U.S., a lot of our country's roses actually come from that area of Ecuador. It's just a wonderful place for growing roses. So maybe we'll start a small rose plantation with the homes. The other idea is we could start a guinea pig farm. Yes, they grow a lot of guinea pig in Ecuador, and they're not for pets. They're to eat. Yeah, they're considered to be a delicacy food in Ecuador.
And yes, they eat them, and yes, we've tried them, and yes, it tastes like chicken. So I just wanted to share a little bit more about the medical clinic. Like we said, it's already pretty much established. Joel just came back from there about a month ago, and these are pictures from that trip, and the clinic is pretty much like 95% complete at this point. So they're just waiting for us to get back down there to staff it. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about kind of what our goals are for the clinic. The first step is just going to be to minister to the children of the home, but also to minister to children in the surrounding areas. This church actually works with a compassion center that has over 500 children in their compassion center. So there's going to be a lot of children to work with there. The second step will hopefully be ministering to the surrounding community. And then the third step will be to take medical caravans up into the mountains further to people that really don't have any type of medical care at all. They live at approximately 10 to 11,000 feet, and there's just not a whole lot of people that go up there to just kind of hang out. So they are really underserved in the medical area. The second area I wanted to talk about is the Santiago Partnership. So we are covenant missionaries. We are going under the ministry and the direction of the Covenant Church of the United States, and we'll be working with the Covenant Church in Ecuador. But we are starting a nonprofit organization called the Santiago Partnership that is actually going to be doing all of the funding for the Centers for At-Risk Children and for the clinic. So we're funded by the Covenant, but the Centers for At-Risk Children and the clinics are all going to be funded through the Santiago Partnership. And this is something that we're coming up with. And these are just pictures of friends of ours that are going to be on the board of directors for this nonprofit organization that came down right before we left and really got to see firsthand what they're going to be doing and what all of their work is going to be eventually doing. So that's what these pictures are.
We are looking to return to Ecuador in the beginning of 2014 and are hoping to start this project in the middle, like June or July of that same year, 2014. The picture you see up there is Pastor Jose and his church behind him, Iglesia Emmanuel, the first church and pastor that we're going to be partnering with for the first home. As Kim was saying, I just visited there about a month ago, and I was spending some time with Pastor Jose, and he shared with me a story about how he had recently was visiting with some folks from the poorer part of town, and there was specifically a young couple that were very poor, just recently had twin babies born, and those babies were actually sleeping on the ground in their home because they didn't have anywhere else for them to sleep. They just put a blanket out and were let him sleep there. What he said to me is, Joel, I need help because our church can only do so much, and I want to be able to minister to families like these. So I want your help. What we're here to share this morning is that we need your help. We need help in getting back to Ecuador and starting this project. We are seeking ministry partners to join our team of those who support our ministry through prayer and giving. And the members of our ministry support team can be individuals, they can be churches, or even small groups. We need help to start these ministries that will help to reunify families and make them whole and serve those who are lacking basic medical service. Just to share a little bit about the importance of prayer, our supporters' commitment to prayer is vital to our ministry. It's prayer and God's providence in our ministry that will sustain us in the long term and will get us through those difficult days. We can't tell you how many times we felt and have needed those prayers from our supporters and how God answered those prayers and met us right where we were at. To share briefly also about our financial needs so we can get back to Ecuador, we are currently 48% funded in terms of our monthly supporters, or its amount of $4,700 per month, and we need to get to a level of $9,700 per month. And if I could share, the church here, you guys, First Covenant Church of Wilmar, is already supporting us with 3%. So we thank you so, so much for your continued support of us. We do need more help in getting back, and just to share an example of ways that people can partner with us, if 20 individuals this morning wanted to support us $30 per month, you would actually be able to triple the support that First Covenant Church Wilmar is doing. Monthly support commitments are what are needed most. It's our monthly supporters that are really helpful as long-term missionaries because of their commitment to sustained regular giving that supports our ongoing ministry expenses that we have year in and year out. In the end, we all know that not everyone can go. What's needed is that you all can be an active part of missionary work by praying and supporting our ministry. In that way, you all are going. You are a support team that we together are making a difference in Ecuador, in the lives of at-risk children, with reunifying them with their families, and also by serving the medically underprivileged in the name of Jesus Christ and the Covenant Church of Ecuador. We're going to be outside, right outside the sanctuary afterwards. Feel free to stop by and talk with us. We actually have a little prayer card as well as some additional information to give you and a free gift for you from Ecuador. So please come and see us. Thank you so much. It's great to be here with you all.
I think it's really clear that God is doing something very special in Ecuador. And he's doing something very special with the at-risk children in Ecuador. And we've had the privilege to be a part of that, and we want to continue to pray to see how we can even be a bigger part of that. So before I pray this morning, as we close out this service, just to let you know, there will be prayer available up front. So someone will be up here to pray with you for any needs that you have. Joel and Kim will be in the back. Talk to them, find out more about it. But let's pray together, shall we? Lord God, we thank you for the way that you're working. Thank you for Joel and Kim and Simeon. Thank you that they could be here with us this morning. And we pray that you would continue to bless them. And even as you have given them vision and they have seen your miraculous hand at work in their lives, we are trusting you that it's going to go from 48% to 97%, or the 9,700, I should say, of support. And we pray that would happen soon so that their timetable, they could move forward, they could get to Ecuador and begin this important work with the kids, with the clinic, and just what a difference that can make in finding the lost and helping the hurting. And so, God, be with them even as they travel today. Bless them, provide for them, and we pray as a church. We pray that you would be with us at First Covenant. We have had a partnership with our brothers and sisters in Ecuador. We thank you for them. Show us those next steps. What's next? What's that next trip? What are those ways that we can partner with giving, with sending, with going? Because we want to do what you call us to do. We want to do it here in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost ends of the earth. And now would you stand for the benediction? Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, to the close of the age. Amen. Go with joy.